Good evening, everybody. I'm Rajendra Roy. I'm the Celeste Bartos Chief Curator of Film here at MoMA. It's such a great pleasure to welcome you here tonight for this incredible anniversary, the 20th anniversary of Requiem for a Dream. If you haven't had a chance to watch the film recently, or just before tonight's conversation, Requiem for a Dream, Director's Cut 4K will be available October 13th on 4K Ultra HD and digital, and it is streaming now. Before we get started, I'd like to recognize the donors who make film at MoMA possible, especially Debra and Leon Black, for their exceptional commitment in creating the Black Family Film Center here at MoMA, as well as our annual Film Fund donors, many of whom I hope are watching tonight. Also, as always, a big thanks to Chanel, our lead sponsor of film here at MoMA. They've been so generous and adventurous in following us from our work on 53rd Street now into the virtual realm. Thank you to everybody at Chanel. Of course, a warm welcome to all of our MoMA members tuning in. If you're not already a member, consider becoming one at moma.org/join for special events like this one and priority access to MoMA all year round, which you can have access to the actual museum now, as Darren can attest, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. All of you watching can use the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen to submit questions, which our producers will get to me and we'll bring them to the group for discussion later on. But now, I'd especially like to thank this incredible panel of creatives who have joined us tonight. Please welcome director Darren Aronofsky. Wait, Darren. Actors Ellen Burstyn, Jared Leto, Jennifer Connelly, and Marlon Wayans. Thank you all so much for being here tonight.
How you doing?
Hanging in there, you know, hanging in there. Darren, good to see the bottom half of your face. I saw the top half at MoMA last week, was it? When you came to the galleries.
Yeah. It was amazing to be back at MoMA. And I kind of like what you guys are doing with the, I mean, it's amazing because your general experience at the MoMA is often very crowded. And to have that much space to see the art was a real gift. So it's great for anyone who hasn't gone back. It's great to go back to the museums.
Well, thank you for coming. Thank you for being masked when you were here. It is a special time to be at the museum, especially after we were closed so long. But unfortunately, we can't show movies at MoMA yet. Theaters are still closed. So I wish we could all be on stage together here, but it is a thrill to have you in this space talking about your incredible accomplishment. I mean, for me, going back, you know, unlike some folks who, you know, there's one gentleman who wrote in that Requiem for a Dream is their favorite movie they can't ever watch again. that's not the case for me. It's more that, you know, when I watched it again recently, you know, when I first saw it, I felt like I was so grown up when I saw it, right? It was the year 2000. You know, I was 28 years old. And, you know, a lot of us, not all of us, but we're also in that kind of still not quite a full grown up, but not a kid anymore zone. Obviously, Ms. Burstyn, you were more of an adult. You've always been probably more an adult than us. But it was an inflection point, I think, for a lot of us. And, you know, this film really changed the course for all of you in a way, the way I kind of like went back and looked at the history. But one thing I kind of like to just start with is that this film, in a way, feels like an unbettered culmination of what happens when you have, you know, an opioid addiction epidemic, when you have mass media mania, when you have, you know, a racist incarceration system, all of the things that we are living right now. And I'm wondering if each of you could just speak a little bit to the frame of mind you had, if you can remember 20 years ago, addressing this story that Darren and Hugh Selby wrote together for this screenplay, and your thoughts now about living in the society we do that unfortunately is probably less hopeful than maybe we thought it might be 20 years ago. But Darren, I'll let you lead off on that.
Wow, it's a big one. And definitely a really interesting question. I did have a thought. I was thinking about the scene with Jared and Marlon in the jail, and you know, the N-word is muttered and there's a racial intensity throughout those scenes that, you know, were hardcore when I read them in the novel. They were super hard doing on set. And then just thinking about them now, they're just incredibly hurtful and painful. I think what Cubby always did with his writing, Cubby is a nickname for Hubert Sub Jr. That I was lucky enough to be able to call him. The kind of honesty and open wound pain that he writes with was always what kind of inspired me. Just finding the incredible poetry in his words, describing people being the worst versions of themselves, and how good people can slide into that reality. It just always moved me. It's shocking at times, but the humanity of the film is from Cubby's original kind of inspiration. I think everything he ever put into the world was all about that. Unfortunately, it's sad that the world hasn't changed that much, I guess. It's changed in many, many ways, but in other ways, it's stayed exactly the same.
Ms. Burstyn, maybe I'll direct this to you as well. And I'm just wondering if you recall having a, you know, obviously there's so much heartbreak in the film, but there's also the potential, I think, for optimism. Do you remember any, you know, kind of whether you had optimism about anything related to these characters or the trajectory that we might take based on their experiences afterwards?
You know, it seemed to me that Sarah was driven to be her best self. And she had a skewed idea of what that might be. That she was very ambitious and very dedicated to recapturing something that she felt got away.
Yeah.
And if only she could be thin enough to fit in that red dress, she could get it back and be on television.
Yeah.
What that represented to her and what it represents to so many people of being famous or being seen, really, just being seen. And so there, it seems to me there's a yearning in people to unflower, is the word that's coming to mind, to that they feel something in themselves that could have been and wish it were, and maybe it still can be, and they don't have a real clear idea of just what that is. And so they reach for something that they think will be satisfying or enlightening or something, but it's a false image. And there's the tragedy that they don't ever actually connect with their deepest self.
Yeah, I love that, you know, just thematically. I think everybody in the film, we all had, every character had something they was dreaming for, something that they were reaching for, their own way out. And it's funny how the things of your past, it's the reasons why people do drugs that hold you back. And what I love about Requiem, as much as it was about, like, you know, it was the greatest PSA for don't do drugs ever.
Not true.
Oh my God. Everybody I know that, every coffee shop I go into, man, I quit crack when I got it, when I seen Requiem. It's because everybody had something they was dreaming for, but everybody had something that was, you know, this pain, this deep-seated pain in their life that led them to the drug, that led them to the demise. And I just thought it was a beautiful roller coaster to basically like hell. And it was the greatest ride, the greatest high. And then it's just like crash. And the audience, I think, is blessed with the leftover with the thing of, you know, with the real gift. Sorry, my dad called me.
No, I mean, look, I mean, in all seriousness, you know, movies do save lives. I mean, let's, you know, art does save lives in some cases. And so I actually believe that some people may have come out of this, you know, chastened about, you know, endeavoring to try any of this. But Jared and Jennifer, I was wondering, you know, in this vein, you know, I imagine finding that trust between each other as actors would have been so critical. Obviously, you had to trust in your director. But I'm wondering if you could just riff with each other a little bit, if you remember, about setting up that relationship and setting up the boundaries of trust that must have been intense.
What you say, Jennifer? Do you want to riff a little bit? I just got to say, like, seeing everybody's face, it's very emotional for me. I feel like I feel so lucky to have had this opportunity. I remember begging Darren for the job. I remember being just floored that I got to work with Ellen and Jennifer and Mark. I just feel so connected to you guys, even though we're not, you know, texting every day. And I haven't seen so many of you in so long, but I just feel this like really deep personal satisfaction and pride and gratitude that I remember this movie so clearly. I think every single day, I remember walking the streets with Marlon at night. I remember all the research and the rehearsals that we all did in that little room with Darren and all the crazy stuff that we talked about and the time that I spent with Jennifer. It was just so sacred. All of it to me was just so sacred and so beautiful. I could talk about it for a very long time, but just have an enormous sense of gratitude to see your faces and to have been a part of this film. And I just want to thank you guys for that.
Yeah, I had a similar experience to Jared. I really fought to get that part. I don't know, Darren, how many times did I audition? I auditioned a bunch of times. It was a few times.
My memory of it, and Jared, you were there. Maybe you auditioned once for me alone, but what I remember is being like, oh, Jennifer, yeah, I like her work. I haven't seen her. I got it, you know, and she came in and Jared was there and you came in and you destroyed the room. You threw a chair over.
Yeah, she like kicked the chair across.
She kicked the chair, right? And she walked out and me and Jared looked at each other and it was like done. We saw each other. We were like, all right, she got the part. So I don't remember torturing you at all, but please.
Jennifer, don't feel bad. I auditioned 6 times.
That's true. Right? I didn't believe in you, Marlon.
Bro, you didn't believe at all. I was like, wow, really, Darren? 6 times. I had my own hit TV show on the air. I was like 6 times. I remember I slept the night before in my heroin clothes. I was talking like this dude all week. I went in audition one time. He's like, ah, it's good. I met with him. I auditioned 6 times. I damn near paid him to do the movie.
Yeah.
I think I think the last day I bought everybody lobster, I think that was everything I made on the movie. I donated it back as a wrap gift to the cast. I mean, to the whole crew. I bought lobster.
Sorry, I interrupted you, Jennifer. Please.
Point being that to be there. I mean, I think that all of us felt that way. I was so felt really important to me to be there. I wanted it so badly. I wanted to be part of that story so badly. And so I was kind of all in. I think I threw all of myself at it. So in terms of connecting with everyone, any opportunity that we had, I was so grateful to be there in every moment and to completely surrender to the experience and, you know, be as available as possible as I could be to everyone in all moments, because it just felt like something special was going to happen.
Yeah. So I'm the film has been lauded all across the boards. I mean, Ms. Burstyn, we'll get into that. It would probably be easier to name the awards you were not nominated for in relation to this film, because you were very justly rewarded for your work there. But one thing that does, you know, jump out at most people is the incredible work that you all did with Maddie Levitique, the cinematographer. It felt, you know, as a viewer, it feels very participatory. Like, I mean, at certain points, I think even you all were probably strapped in on, had cameras. I mean, I want to know how that all went down. And Ms. Burstyn, you know, in watching the kitchen table scene, I'm not sure how it's actually described in the script, but that intense close-up that you have, Jared is your scene partner, but really that intense partner, you know, close-up monologue almost that you have. I'm wondering if each of you could just give a set experience of working with Maddie or working specifically with the camera work to talk to us how that was for you, because I can imagine it was in some ways very new.
Well, of course, the camera was strapped on me one time for where I was walking, and I was the dolly, yeah, carrying the camera. That's the only time in my 60 some odd year career that I've ever been the dolly.
Low budget film.
And then there was that, what do you call it, Darren? The fast shot.
The time lapse shot of you cleaning the apartment.
Yeah, and I really did clean the apartment. I really did all of that. And it moved, the camera moved fast with special settings, so it's a remarkable piece of filmdom, and I never experienced anything like it before or after, because I moved as fast as I could, which was pretty fast, and then the camera made it seem even more so. So it was, we were very aware of our interplay with Maddie, and how much the actors and the camera and the special effects and the lighting, and it was all part of it. You know, it's the refrigerator moving, and when the world fell apart, it was terrifying somehow. It was very real on the set. And it felt like teamwork. All the various departments were involved and engaged and giving their all, and it had a high intensity degree of creativity at its most fertile and vital and tough and hard and exciting and terrifying. It was quite an experience.
It sounds like it. Darren, can you just talk to us a little bit about how you and Maddie would choreograph this, talk to the actors, talk to the crew about how this was all going to go down?
Well, there was, it's just a lot of conversations. It starts with just talking about the project in front of you and talking about the themes that make up the story. And then moment by moment, recognizing where the camera is supposed to be. But there was a general like approach of starting off wider and brighter and sunnier and warmer, and moving through the seasons of how the book was structured to a much darker, colder, muted, tighter frame. At one point, I wanted to do the whole third act winter in just extreme close-ups. But Maddie was smart in saying, maybe that's a little too much, get a little more coverage, which was very wise advice. But you know, filmmaking is like how Ellen explains, that's what I always trying to do, is create a set where everyone is contributing, their specialty, their artistry, to, one type of, you know, score or movement together. And when you have everyone fighting to be the top of their game or give something from the top of the game, it's a great place to be, inspiring. And I feel sitting here in my basement, I feel very, very jealous of the of that moment right now.
Yeah. Jennifer, I'll send this to you, but obviously anyone can answer. I mean, this was shot in an era before, you know, on-set intimacy, awareness was, you know, top of mind in the way that it is now. And I'm just wondering if you can recall how, you know, that that safety was constructed for you in particular.
Yeah, there were some pretty intense scenes, one in particular. Yeah, I don't know. I think I was in a bit of a, it was different then for sure. I was so focused on what she was going through, honestly. I felt like I was kind of just in my own world. And I think that the people around her, it was all kind of a blur at that time, you know, in that scene. And I think I honestly was, it was a bit like that for me too, to be frank. I mean, it was definitely intense, but I felt like it was really important for the film and appropriate for the film. And, you know, I really trusted Darren and do trust Darren and had so much respect for him and what he was doing. So I kind of just did my thing and trusted Darren to do his.
Yeah.
Isn't the point that safety wasn't an issue? I mean, that's not what you were thinking of at the time. You were throwing yourself into a role fully and in every way. And this film had a level of abandonment and commitment that it just wasn't. I mean, you think of safety, you don't want to be hurt, but it doesn't seem to me that you could do what you did, Jennifer, if that was what you were concerned with. Am I wrong?
It wasn't what I was thinking about, for sure. I mean, I was just thinking about, you know, who she was and where she was and completely surrendering myself to that experience and that scene and kind of, like I said, trusting Maddie and trusting Darren and how everything would come together, because I kind of just once we decided on talked about what it was going to be and everything was agreed on, I just kind of I just gave my all to it, you know.
So following on that, maybe to Jared first and then to Marlon as well, I'm wondering if there were some on set experiences that you have kind of embraced or absorbed and taken and then used later on in the subsequent 20 years since this film has been made. Anything practical that you gained from this experience?
I mean, I guess the cliche that hard work pays off. This movie was all about commitment, and it started with Darren, and like I think all of us have mentioned so far, you just felt like there was an opportunity here that something special might be happening. And I, like everyone else, was so excited to be a part of this group, to be a part of the source material. Cubby, Darren's previous work spoke so loudly and was so groundbreaking, Pi, that I think everyone thought, okay, this is a really rare chance to see what you're made of, to go to a place you hadn't gone to before, to learn a lot. And so we had had that sense that we were part of something unique, and I still do. I still feel that way. What do you think, Darren? I do remember with Ellen, the first scene that I had, which was that scene you spoke about in her house, I was so amped up and I was so raring to go that I lost my voice. And I had to come back. Like the worst thing that could happened. I couldn't even speak, but she was so good. It's like playing tennis with, you know, McEnroe, whoever. she was so good. I recognized immediately in the scene. I was like, oh, she's not gonna let me fail. And it was just like this enormous gift. And I saw her dedication, her commitment, and I saw Ma, I saw her there. And, you know, and Darren is just the best. He's an actor's dream because he's a nut and he'll go the distance with you. He never says no to any of the conversation. He's always open. He likes the debate and the discussion. He likes to push and to prod and to get to something great. And I think I had that feeling like, you know, between Ellen and Jennifer, Marlon and Darren and Maddie, that no one was gonna let me fail. So I felt a little more, you know, empowered to take some risks, I suppose.
Darren challenges you. As soon as you walk on the set, you're challenged. I came out a month early, I believe we started filming. I came out a month early. And this man made me take off my shirt and said, where are we going? So we're going for a walk. It was February. And I walked around the streets in New York with my shirt off. And I said, what are we doing? What kind of mind trick is this? And he goes, I just want you to know, remember what it feels like to be cold in February. I mean, now, because we're going to be filming the winter and the summer. And I want you to remember how this feels. And I was like, dude, I grew up here. I know exactly how it feels. I didn't have a jacket. We were poor. I don't need this. But that's just the, I remember he would tell me things like, you know, he asked me, there's another mind trick. Give me five things you love. I was like, I love sugar. No, three things. I love sugar. I love sex. And I love, like, I think at the time, and liquor. He goes, great. Here's what you can't have for the next month. He called it a month of wrath. And he said, I couldn't have those three things. And I swear, and I did it. And I was talking to him, and I was younger at the time. And he goes, every day would check on me. How you feel? I feel like crazy. Like, I feel like I want some sex. I want some sugar. I want a glass of wine. He's like, now you know how junkies feel. And I was like, word. But that little mind thing, these little mind tricks they play you, just, you know, I think he had such a challenge because every one of these actors that were on board to give their all, we all gave ourselves. I gave myself. Whatever you wanted, I was there. If you want whatever you need, I'm there. And I think all of us had that same level of commitment, but we also knew that he had our back. When I had a sex scene, of course, when it was only 20 seconds long, we did a 45-minute take. But you know what? It was a closed set. It was Darren, script supervisor, and like one or two other people. He kept it nice and close, and he always made us feel safe and protected. And kudos to him for that.
Thank you. I did just to, it's interesting. It's like, it's all pointing in the same direction, which is like, at a certain point, we had problems with the MPAA with a rating. In fact, the film was released not rated because they wanted to give us an NC-17. And the pressure, you know, came from where they were like, well, if you want to be rated R, you got to trim this, you got to trim that, you got to trim this. And it was almost a bit from each of the characters seen, from the torture of Sarah to the torture of all the characters. And I remember, you know, the studio coming to me going, look, we can end up, we could get released in these theaters and we can make this much more money if we go with the rated R version. And I felt it undermined the whole point of the project, because the film is about how far addiction will push you to do the most inhumane things to the people you love and to yourself. And if we retreated from that in any way, it would undermine the exact, you know, reason for the existence of the piece. So I think all of us understood that we had to take the audience all the way there. Otherwise, there was no reason to do the project.
So as you've just pointed out, you know, the film is always thought of as such heavy, and we are drawn to, I think, you know, these really intense stories of human suffering. What, you know, for whatever reason, these are stories that are compelling and do move us, and you know, have given us some of the most transcendent works on cinema and on stage. But what I was also shocked to not recall at all was that there's a good amount of humor in this film. I'm not exactly sure that it's funny, but I found myself laughing. And Ms. Burstyn, I mean, specifically you and your battles with your house, your kitchen, and with food. And again, this is not, you know, it's not funny, but it was, I was laughing, right? And
I'm wondering, you have a dark sense of humor. I'm just saying,
ass to ass.
No, I know. But like the donuts from space and, you know, this, you know, and you know, the alive refrigerator. Ms. Burstyn, maybe you could just lead off, like, was that something you were conscious of, that this might, you know, elicit laughter, or, you know, or was it, what was that like?
With the Are you flat? Asking me?
Yeah.
Well, it is funny, because it's so absurd. It's horrifying at the same time. I think it's a combination. And I find sometimes I laugh at the most horrifying things, because it's like, oh my God, look where we're going. And it's you laugh when you're so tense, you can hardly stand it, and you laugh. And I think that the intention was never to be funny, but the intention of going as far as you can go sometimes produces laughter. So I'm glad I gave you a couple of laughs.
It's like your sense of humor is so dark.
No,
he's but there's an electric shock treatment.
No, you're talking about the end, Marlon, but he's talking more like earlier in the film. It is kind of bonkers.
Bonkers is the right word. Yeah. Okay. What was the set like? I mean, I, you know, knowing Darren Aronofsky, it was probably a laugh a minute, but. Maybe with Marlon, is that any fun set story, onset stories for the audience?
People often ask, like, how painful is the experience of making your films? And I don't find them painful at all, and I don't think people do. I think moment by moment between action and cut, there's a tremendous amount of concentration, and often at times the actors are going through some serious emotional channeling that has an intensity. But what I like about all of these actors is, like, when you call cut, we go back to them being themselves. I think Jared was probably the most method, like he would walk away and take that emotion with him and try to hold it and store it and nurture it, was my take. And, or, you know, we would leave Jared to do his thing, but Marlon very much is Marlon the second you call cut. Ellen, when she's going deep into emotions, like I can remember when she was like channeling some heavy duty stuff, she would do similar to Jared. She would go off. She would always be there. So like I could just go, Ellen, and she'd look at me and I'd give her a note, and I could see Ellen underneath the character taking the note and turning it into the energy that she was still kind of keeping until the next time we would call action. And Jennifer is like a complete, it's strange to call her a veteran, but she is a complete, has always been an inspiration, her ability. One story I tell, which has nothing, just because I want to say something really nice about Jennifer, is that we didn't work together for like 15 years or some ridiculous amount. And then we got to work together on Noah. And it was like, I watched a really great, uber talented actor become a master. Like I worked with her when she was super talented. And then by the time she got to me on Noah, it was a master class. So I was like, wow, this is a craft. There is a, you know, this craft can be developed and turned and grown. Anyway, that's my nice story about Jen.
Jennifer, do you want to retaliate with a nice story or otherwise?
Oh, no, please don't. Talk about color.
I'm sure you got some.
Well, you know, I would just say it's, in terms of the atmosphere on the set, I felt like it was such a privilege to be there. I Even when it's like the subject matter is difficult and, you know, these characters are being tortured, it's, you know, being given that opportunity to really delve into something is such an extraordinary gift. So I think all of us, I know I was felt so grateful in every moment to be there. And I think Darren's just a genius, you know, and I was so excited to work with him the first time. I was so overjoyed that he wanted to work with me again and would do it any time. I think he's an extraordinary filmmaker, which is why we're all here.
Well, just on the NOAA front, I can share with you both that my niece, who is in her junior year of college on the West Coast, thankfully, still in school, had to write a paper about NOAA.
Wow.
So she called up her uncle who had a thought or two, but just so you know, you are being studied. Your collaboration is currently being studied. But,
nice.
Beautiful.
You know, Ms. Burstyn, you know, you were nominated for Best Actor, Actress for this performance. And, you know, you went through a whole cycle of, you know, the awards and talking about this film and sharing it with folks. I'm just wondering any recollections of that period, you know, for, like I mentioned at the outset, this was an inflection point. I think a lot of us got to know Jared through this film and certainly got to know Marlon as a dramatic actor and, you know, had our fandom of Jennifer affirmed through this film, those of us who had been following for a long time. But this really, for many of us, was a chance to celebrate you in this, you know, new generation moment. Just wondering what that felt like to kind of go through that whole rigmarole of acclaim after, you know, you had been through that before, obviously.
Yeah, I want to tell you a story that's not exactly about awards, but I noticed after a few years went by after this film, say like 10 years, that I was known to young people for that film. People who hadn't seen Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore or The Last Picture Show or even The Exorcist, but they knew me from that film. And I became aware of that. And I did a play in London and I lived near that big Ferris wheel.
Yeah.
I don't know if you call it a Ferris wheel in London. And I wanted to take some pictures from it. And I never got to until the last day that I was in London. And I got over to the wheel to take pictures and they wouldn't let me on because somebody had rented the wheel for a private thing. And they wouldn't sell me a ticket. And so I went up to the people who were taking tickets. And I said, they won't sell me a ticket to get on, but I'm leaving London and I really would like to get on to take some pictures. Is there any way I can get on? And she said, no, and kind of rudely and had nothing to do with me. And I thought for a moment, I thought, how can I do this? I said, did you ever see a movie called Requiem for a Dream?
Love it.
And she said, yes. And I said, well, that was me in it. She said, you're kidding. Oh, wow. Yeah, you can get on, go on.
That is incredible. Well,
Marlon's, that's the only way Marlon gets tickets to anything.
That's exactly. The only way I got in the Academy was because of her.
Well, I will share that, Ms. Burstyn, you're about to have a whole new generation appreciate your work for a whole new film. I will say that I have seen probably the most remarkable performance of the year that you gave in Pieces of a Woman, a new film that launched in Venice. And I was just destroyed by what you did. Once again, you have kind of elevated what I can come to expect from a screen performance. So everybody should get ready and check that out, hopefully coming soon to a theater.
I've seen it. It's great.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I did. I forgot to tell you. I'll tell you later.
Okay. Isn't Vanessa her being divine in it? She just
truly, and she deserves every accolade, which she will surely get. But she could not have done what she did without you there as her partner, and you elevated that film in many ways. So thank you for that. I know we have a heart out with our guests this evening now, but I do want to thank all of you for joining us, for sharing these stories, and for sharing this movie with the world. I mean, it's as poignant and relevant, probably in new and even more powerful ways today than it was 20 years ago. So thank you, everybody, and I hope to see you at MoMA soon.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, guys.
Bye, guys. Bye. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye, Jack.